serving today at St. John's Lutheran Church. We have the reader is Diane Myers, communion assistant Sally Baker, ushers are Bill and Mary Nevius. You can join us every Sunday morning at 8 o'clock or 10:30 a.m. We are located on Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. We're glad to have you visit with us every Sunday morning. Sunday school is at 9:15 a.m. and we have a midweek service at 6:30 p.m. every Wednesday. There is nursery care at the 10 a.m. service.
Thank you. 203 in the front of your room. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Thank you. he might taste for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, in bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
sermon today is titled, What Do You Say?
Again, as I said, if you wish to turn to the sermon text, it is Amos chapter 5, verse 13. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
The shootings this week in Oregon remind us how again and again we are confronted with evil. And unfortunately, when such evil appears and takes place, too often people are quick to make explanations about what happened. Too often politicians and the Hollywood crowd give a knee-jerk reaction before all the facts are in. And unfortunately, all this does is make the situation worse. It makes the situation harder on the families and the victims. It makes it harder on law enforcement trying to untangle the web of evidence. And in some instances, it makes it harder for there to be healing in a community or in our nation. So what should we do? What should we say when something like Oregon happens? What should we say? What should we do? As I believe, follow the advice that the prophet Amos gave to Israel centuries ago. Amos was called by God to be a prophet to the nation of Israel at a time of Israel's greatest prosperity since the reigns of David and Solomon. They were expanding their borders. They were expanding their influence. They had wealth. They had money coming in from all kinds of places. But it was a sick society. In their prosperity, they were oppressing the poor. In their prosperity, in the marketplace, were crooked scales that enabled merchants to give you less for what you were paying for. It was a time when there was injustice in social dealings, there was an abhorrent morality, and there was a shallow, meaningless piety with no fear of God. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Well, being made by the poor become poor. Oppression of those who were different. Money in the bottom line being a motivation for many actions. A morality that continues to go down the toilet. And a lack of fear of God. A lack of fear for the Lord. A lack of respect for His word. And it is into this environment that the prophet Amos said in verse 13, therefore, he who is prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Contrast that to what happens so often. Therefore, he or she who is prudent, the word prudent means to have understanding, to have wisdom, to have skill, to be intelligent. So the person who has understanding, the person who has wisdom, the person who has skill, the person who is intelligent will keep silent at such a time. And here the word time means circumstances. So they will keep quiet in such circumstances, for it is an evil time. The word evil means to be wicked. It means to be a time of immoral activity. It means to be a time of unethical activity. And so the prophet is saying, when these situations happen, don't immediately say something. Be quiet at first. Let all the facts come in. Instead of trying to come up with something to say, try to figure out what you can do to help the situation or to prevent the situation from happening again. But so often, we see people running to make a statement. And we see people immediately trying to That says blame. This side says one thing, this side says another thing. And the sad reality is, in a couple of weeks, it will all be forgotten until the next tragedy. It will be like a poor, beat-up man lying on the road to Jericho, whom the priest and the Levite passed right by. We will just pass by this tragedy and go on about business and usual. So what is Amos telling us as a community of faith we should do if to have understanding, to have wisdom, to have skill, to have intelligence in such circumstances is to keep silent? And if it is true that this is a wicked time, an immoral time, an unethical time, then what are we as Christians supposed to do? This Amos saying we just bury our head in the sand. That we use the common excuse that we hear today so often, everybody's doing it. Or are we being challenged to do something? If we left Amos with just verse 13, it could be argued that he is telling us to do nothing. But just like any text, you have to have it in context. And after he says these words, he says, seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, as you have said. Hate evil, love good, and establish justice. We are being called as a community of faith to be that light to the world. You have heard me say time and time again how when the covenant was made with the Hebrew children, that they were to be a light unto the nations. That was the responsibility God was giving them. He was choosing them not so that they could puff out their chest and beat their chest and say, God loves us and hates all you Gentiles. No, he called them to be the ones who would enlighten the rest of the world what God was really like and what God really wanted and how God wanted us to live in relation to him and each other. And they failed to do it. As time went by, they became more introverted as they suffered defeats and they suffered being conquered by the Assyrians and the Babylonians and the Greeks and then the Romans. They took that being God's chosen as meaning just them. So then Jesus Christ comes into the world with the new covenant. And he gives to us who would follow him that command to go into all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that he has commanded. And what he commands us is that we are to love one another. We are to love good and not evil. We are to love our neighbor as ourselves. We are to love one another as he loved us. So that instead of coming out with some statement so we can have this soundbite of the evening news, we go about doing things. We act instead of talk. And unfortunately, as we see today, there's far too much talking and very little action. We as a church, we as the followers of Jesus Christ, must stand up to society. We can no longer be silent. We can no longer be bullied by the non-constitutional statement of separation of church and state, which is a phrase from Jefferson's letter to a group of Baptists to assure them that the state could not affect how they worship. We need to stand up for those teachings of Jesus Christ. When we look back at our history, and we see with those centuries where the Judeo-Christian heritage influenced almost everything our nation did, we see a time when our society was much more united as we see a society where there was far less violence. The one thing that makes people scratch their head is that according to the FBI, gun violence actually is down when it comes to people using guns on each other. But it's these massacres that have gone on. What has changed in society that people think that they've got a break, they can go kill a bunch of innocent people? And at the same time, what is it with our society that they keep telling us as Christians that we're supposed to be tolerant? And they accuse us of being intolerant. But when is the last time a Christian went to a group of atheists and shot them up because he didn't like atheists? Because they put up a billboard and made fun of our faith or belittled the Lord Jesus Christ? When was the last time a Christian went into a group of Muslims or Buddhists or Hindus or Taoists or Confucius or Shintos or Jainists or whatever and shot them up because of their faith? Yet we're the ones that are supposed to be tolerant. And yet everybody that hates us attacks us. As we heard on the news, this gentleman would ask the individual if they were a Christian. If they said yes, they immediately got a bullet in the head. If they said no or didn't answer or said they were another religion, they got shot in the leg. Those people, knowing death was staring them in the face, would not back down from their commitment to Jesus Christ. And so therefore, in their honor, we as a church must stand up. We must again be motivated by that message to evangelize the world. As Jesus said in John 15, verse 18, he's in the upper room, it's the night of his betrayal. He's instituted the Lord's Supper, his baptism, he's washed the apostles' feet. He's been teaching them these last instructions. Verse 18, he says, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. So we should expect the world to try to reject our message. We should expect society to try to muzzle us, but we don't give in to them by being quiet. When the early Christians were marched into the Colosseum and the wild beasts were turned loose on them, they didn't say, oh, throw up their hands and say, we've got to give up. Rome's just too powerful. We can't ever defeat them. When they were nailed to crosses, burned at the stake, beheaded, fried alive, flayed alive, drawn and quartered, they didn't say, oh, got to give up. Instead, what they did was that motivated them to even more fervently proclaim the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that is what we must do. We must stop being a silent church. We must be a church on fire. We must be a church filled again with that Holy Spirit that enables us to go to every village, every hamlet, every town, to every continent, to every island, to every atoll, to every isthmus, to every part of the world, to proclaim that good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Seek good and not evil. Hate evil and love good. Establish justice. If we don't do it, who? If not now, when? We don't speak, we act. There was a young man that joined the army, went off to boot camp. First night of boot camp, came bedtime, he got down on his knees, he prayed. Some of the other soldiers in the barracks started hooting and hollering, whistling, calling names. Even some of them threw boots at their boots at him. This went on for 3, 4, 5 days, nights. Fifth day, he went to see the chaplain. Told the chaplain what was happening. Chaplain to him and said, well, son, you've got to remember, you're not home anymore. You're not in your own bedroom. That barracks is owned by everybody who's in your squad or platoon or whatever it is in a barracks. He said, so if they don't like you praying, they've got a right to object because they're living there too. So, you know, it doesn't matter how you pray, so why don't you wait and get in bed and say your prayers while you're lying in your bunk? So the young soldier tried that. Well, the chaplain didn't see this young soldier for several weeks, and then finally he ran into him on the base and he asked him how it was going. And he said, well, did you follow my advice? And the young man said, yes, chaplain, for about 4 days I followed your advice. About the fourth day I felt like a whipped hound on me. He said, just one of the same. So on that fifth night I got back on my knees and I prayed. And he said, the most wonderful thing happened. He said, we now have a prayer meeting every night in my barracks. He said, 5 of the biggest bullies that were bullying me for my faith have now come to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. See, he could have hidden in his covers and kept his faith hidden. But by his example, 5 non-believers were led to faith in Jesus Christ. And that is what it takes. As Amos says, if we're prudent, we won't say anything at the moment of some kind of horrible action. But what we will do is act. We will find ways of offering comfort. We will find ways of trying to change people's hearts. Think back to the 80s. Think back to when the AIDS epidemic began. There were those churches that dominated TV, and those preachers that organized the Christian March on Washington in the 80s and had all this fame throughout the land. All they did in the AIDS epidemic was condemn the people who had AIDS, condemn their lifestyles, condemn their actions. Our church, the Lutheran church, didn't condemn anyone. Instead, we went into the areas where the most affected and set up clinics and set up chapels and set up agencies to work with people and families who had someone who had AIDS, to bring them comfort and strength and to help them through those last days. See, not speaking, being silent and acting. I can still remember that. It's one thing. Reason I hate to see the old LCA go out of existence, because the LCA used to have that fall campaign, love compels action. The love of Jesus Christ compels us to act. To act on behalf of the Lord Jesus Christ, to bring an end to suffering, to help the widow, the orphan, the stranger in our midst. It calls us to help the poor and the oppressed, instead of just making sound bites for the 6 o'clock news. But there are those who are afraid to witness. And here are a list of the most common excuses why people don't witness. One, I'll do more harm than good. If you're relying on the Holy Spirit, you're probably not going to do any harm. And now, occasionally, there may be somebody, like the eccentric barber in this little town, who was zealous for the Lord and wanted to lead everybody to Christ. And one day a fellow came in to get a haircut and sat down in his chair and laughed. He gave him his haircut and lathered his face all up, and took the old razor like he used to do, those of you who remember, and sharpened the razor on that razor strap, and he came toward him with the razor and said, "Are you ready to meet your God?" Well, then that poor customer jumped up out of his chair, lathered face, the apron, whatever called, still around, ran down the street screaming. That you may do more harm than good for the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you're really trying to share and witness with people, the Holy Spirit will give you what to say. People say, "I don't know what to say." Again, the Holy Spirit. Rely on the Holy Spirit, not on your intellect. I won't be able to give a snappy answer to a tricky question. Well, Jesus never said we had to be snappy. He just said, believe. He said, believe in him and believe in the power of the Holy Spirit, the advocate, the comforter who is coming after me, who will give you what to say and who will strengthen you to be my witnesses throughout the world. Some say, "Well, I might seem bigoted." You won't be bigoted if you're sharing the good news with everybody. Sure, if you only want certain people in the congregation, then you may seem bigoted. But if you're going to every race, creed, color, national origin, whatever, then no one will accuse you of being bigoted. Some will say, "Well, I may invade somebody's privacy." Well, the story is told of D.L. Moody, the great evangelist, walking down the streets of Chicago, and he saw a fellow leaning up against a light post, and he wanted to be tapping on the shoulder, and he said, "Are you a Christian?" And the man turned around and snarled at Moody. He said, "Go mind your own business," and shook his fist at him. And D.L. Moody responded, "I am doing my business. My business is to make Christians. That is our business. Not to make sound bites for TV. Not to blame one side or the other. But to bring human. To bring people to Christ." Others would say, I'm afraid I might fail. The first missionary, I believe, was in China. He was there 5 years before he got his first convert. Jesus doesn't judge us on numbers. He judges us on faithfulness and commitment. And the last is, I'm afraid I might be a hypocrite. Well, if you recognize you're a sinner, if you recognize that, like all people, you're a sinner and fall short of the glory of God, you're not going to be a hypocrite. You're not going to pass yourself off as something you are. So do not let those keep you from fulfilling that command to share the good news with all people. When there is evil confronting us, when things go wrong, let us take the advice of the prophet Amos and not rush in to speak, but instead let us rush in to act, to share that love of Jesus Christ with those who are hurting, no matter the situation. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for our nation, we may be granted devout and faithful that you would grant them health and healing in accord with his good and gracious will. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who give thanks this day for God's kind mercy upon their lives, that we too would join them in blessing the Lord and not forgetting all his benefits, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For God's grace to our brothers and sisters who now abide in the glory and honor of the crown Jesus, let us give thanks to God that we may be kept from neglecting so great a salvation and be granted a place among them. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Into your hands, dear Father, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, on the cross opened his arms to the Lord. In the night which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is new covenant, my blood shed for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering him for his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming and glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through the healing power of this gift of life. In your mercy, strengthen us through this gift in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. For the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with hymn number 838, Beautiful City. Hymn number 838, Beautiful City.
Thank you for watching St. John's Lutheran Church. The church also offers a church school for ages 3 and 4, nursery and pre-K. For more information, you may call the school office at 937-325-4311. We thank you for joining us in our worship this Lord's Day. I'm Karen Dietrich from St. John's. I hope and pray that God will continue to bless and keep you this day and all your days. We will pray for you. And please continue to pray for us and support our ministry. St. John's Lutheran Church is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our phone number is 937-323-7508.